Hello friends, welcome back to another episode by Engineering Today, and hope you're all having a good time with your family and friends. We have three updates for you today. Let's start with Starship. After several weeks of work at SpaceX's Starbase rocket facility, the company has moved an updated Starship prototype to close by test and launch facilities, where it joined an upgraded Super Heavy booster. Following closely in the steps of Super Heavy Booster 7, B7, which began a comparable phase of pre-flight testing around 2 weeks ago, that Starship prototype, known as Ship 24 or S-24, is currently undergoing pre-flight testing. Their most recent journeys from the factory to the launch pad serve substantially the same purposes, which may pave the way for Starship's first orbital launch attempt later this year if everything goes according to plan. But there's still work to be done for both prototypes. When they started a less dangerous phase of proof testing in May and June, Booster 7 and Ship 24 got off to somewhat bumpy starts. A large steel tube intended to transport liquid methane fuel through Booster 7's liquid oxygen tank and serve as a storage container for landing propellant violently imploded when a vacuum developed inside of it. This implosion was likely brought on by poor sequencing or a minor design flaw. Booster 7 successfully completed two further proof tests shortly after the damaged tube was rebuilt, despite the fact that it took SpaceX many weeks to do it. Several weeks later, during one of Ship 24's initial tests, a much smaller internal pipe that was probably transporting high-pressure gas also failed, causing damage to the heat shield tiles and other nearby piping. The problems with S-24 were less severe and only required a few days to correct, but both were brand new failure modes for the Starship program and served as a reminder that the hardware is still in its infancy and that SpaceX is still a work in progress. However, they also showed SpaceX's capacity to act swiftly in the face of fresh challenges, as both B-7 and S-24 passed further tests with no obvious difficulties following prompt fixes. B-7 and S-24 returned to SpaceX's manufacturing facility for the installation and final touches of the Raptor after concluding the cryogenic proof and thrust simulation testing. While installing six Raptors and finishing up a few other tasks on Ship 24 took around 4 weeks, installing 33 Raptor engines and related heat shielding on Booster 7 took around 6 weeks. Ship 24's preparations did include one notably unusual step concerning its payload bay prototype, aside from the installation of the majority of the Starship's missing heat shield panels. It's not entirely correct to compare SpaceX's first attempt at a Starship payload bay to a huge PEZ dispenser. In a Starlink-only arrangement, satellites will be kept on a rectangular rack that's thought to function like an elevator. The stack of satellites will flow downwards like bullets in a magazine until the entire set is fully deployed as some unidentified device pushes two satellites at a time through Starship's bay door's slot-like opening. If the following tests are successful, Ship 24 may have a few Starlink V2 or Gen 2 satellites loaded into its bay. Ship 24 must pass at least one nominal wet dress rehearsal, which simulates every component of a launch except for engine ignition, and one six-engine static fire before being given the all-clear to fly. However, several tests are significantly more likely. The intensive testing of Starship S-20, including several six Raptor static burns in 2021, will be very helpful for Starship S-24's test campaign. The comparable wet dress rehearsal and static fire test campaign for the Super Heavy B-7, in contrast, will be virtually totally new to SpaceX, with the exception of a single three-engine static fire accomplished by an old rocket prototype last year. It's unknown if the business will try to start testing Ship 24's subsequent phase in the intervals between Super Heavy B-7's static fire tests. Though highly unlikely, SpaceX is technically able to test both Ship 24 and Booster 7 at once. That's all for Starship today. Let's take a look at the second update for today. Disaster aid will be revolutionized by Tesla's new prototype of a solar range extender trailer with Starlink. It was just presented at the IDEAN Expo by Tesla Germany. Even if it's ideally a way to make it easier for customers to travel farther, it might be able to do more. When it was originally observed, it resembled a solar microgrid used to save lives in times of crisis. People will remain linked amid calamities by adding Starlink. It was stated how Starlink itself aids in disasters in a recent interview with the CEO of SpaceX that took place last week at Giga Texas. Being independent of any ground-based infrastructure is one of Starlink's key advantages over other internet service providers. The solar array extender trailer would maintain Starlink's connectivity and availability, and it would help folks who are in disaster zones save lives. They might be created by Tesla as solar microgrids. This would maintain the power for fans and medical equipment. As per Elon Musk, well, just generally, Starlink can offer internet connectivity to locations where floods, fires, and earthquakes have devastated the ground-based infrastructure because it's not dependent on any ground-based infrastructure. That's obviously really useful for saving individuals and enabling people to say, "I need help. I need help." Like, where do you find them? How do you speak with them? But in a number of circumstances, Starlink has already done so. Within the next 3 decades, more than 200 million people could be evicted from their homes due to climate change. In Louisiana, it's already begun. This has been personally observed by Isle de Jean Charles locals. Grand Isle was utterly destroyed by Ida, and just cleaning up the wreckage took months. This is merely my little area of the globe. We can really hope Tesla makes the Starlink-equipped solar trailer range extender, and I really hope they incorporate the internet into the microgrid architecture. Lives will be saved. Now, the final news of the day. A $32.7 million spacecraft that was on its way to the moon to test out an oblique lunar orbit has lost touch, according to NASA. But agency engineers are confident they can fix the issue. The first NASA mission, Capstone, lays the basis for sending people back to the moon for the first time since 1972. About the size of a microwave, the probe is small. The Cislunar Autonomous Positioning System Technology Operations and Navigation Experiment, or Capstone, also known as the Cislunar Autonomous Positioning System, was launched to assess the stability of a strange elliptical orbit around the moon. Since its trajectory must be carefully altered as it travels, Capstone cannot reach the moon until communications are restored. The first adjustment has been delayed, but the satellite still had enough fuel to return to its original course, NASA said in a second statement on Tuesday. Prior to being launched by its Rocket Lab launch vehicle, out of the Earth's orbit and safely separating from the rocket and deploying its solar panels, the satellite gained speed for almost a week. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting. And kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comments section. This will help us to improve.